important to us today to have video and audio tape for this specific event so that we can get it out to our coalition members who are across the nation and with the United Nations, where Mary Sue Barnett and I are hopefully going to be in Geneva. And we can say, hey, look at the video that we made of this great event, of these great women and young men and people that are in the community in Louisville, Kentucky. For those of you who do not know, there is a table that is set up by the Louisville Coalition for CEDAW. I'm not going to assume that everybody knows what CEDAW is, because a lot of people don't know what CEDAW is, but it's a treaty that the United Nations passed that began around 1972, began circulating, 1979, began circulating, and the United States is one of the few countries, I think there's seven still, that haven't ratified, including us.
South Sudan just ratified, so we're one of six.
So we're one of six now, update. we're one of six now that has not ratified this universal treaty, which protects women's rights across the land. We're talking about voting, we're talking about basic reproductive rights, basic abilities to go to school, to own property. The things that most of you, I'm certain, take for granted should not be taken for granted across the world. We're very privileged and we're very lucky to be in the United States and have the kind of protections that we have, which also becomes an issue and a question for us. Why are we doing this? If we're in the U.S. and it's the land of all the things that it is and we have all these protections, why are we doing this? Because at the basic level, even though we have federal protection, we have state protection, in Louisville, we have a lot of local protection, we want to educate everybody as much as we possibly can about what your rights are and to tell other people what their rights are. And we want that not just to be the rights for us, we want that to be the rights for everybody. And so if we know about it, we can tell everybody what it is. And if you know about it, you can tell everybody what it is. So we have put together this incredible panel to talk to you today of young girls and young women. And why did we pick young girls and young women? Because you don't need to hear from me. I'm old. You don't need to hear my experience anymore. I mean, I've been there. I'm a lawyer. I've been a lawyer for a long time now. But what is important is the change that's going to happen. And the change that's going to happen is with the generation that is teenagers and young adults and the ones that are even smaller. I mean, we can help push it, but you guys are going to be the ones that really drive it. And I think that for me, what I've noticed in all the work that I've done, the voices of the younger generation are filtered through reporters, through talking heads. We get these teeny tiny sound bites about what's going on in the world and what's going on with the millennials and with this generation. It's so important for us to hear it from you, from the actual girls and women who've had these experiences, because I think it resonates so much more than just looking at a television screen and hearing a 30-second soundbite about where the last war is and where the refugees are. And for people that have lived through it, for me, I hear it a lot more than it, and it makes it a lot more of an impact. So that's why we got these girls here today. I'm going to introduce them one by one. I want to make sure that you guys know that the table is set up with material for the Coalition for CEDAW. Raise your hand if you are a Louisville CEDAW member, please. Thank you. We were able, with the help of Tina Ward Pugh, who's in the back there and is trying to be anonymous, but I'm not going to let her. No way, Jose. She recently retired from the Louisville Metro Council, and we were able to persuade, thanks to Tina and Annika Scott, too, we were able to persuade the Metro Council to pass a resolution for women and girls that is right now pending through Metro Council doing a study on the wages on what women are paid versus what women are paid and what jobs they're in at the city level, correct? And we have a provision that we investigate affordable access to child care, and the major tenet is freedom from domestic violence and sexual violence, and we have lots of people here that do that kind of work, including retired Judge Jerry Bowles, who I was in front of many, many times for the last 17 years, and was instrumental in the domestic violence legislation, not just here in Kentucky, but all over the nation, which is recognized from the American Bar Association. So to have him here is a coup in itself, and I'm very grateful. And Gretchen Hunt, who works with the KASAP, but I'm going to let her tell you about that because she does a much better job. Nemo Kulkarni is in the back row in orange sweater. She is an immigration lawyer and can answer any questions that most people have that, in my experience about immigration. Nemo and I are attorney members of the CEDAW Coalition. So with that framework, the exciting part is that I have Robin G. here today. We have Robin G. who's going to start us off with a poem that she did herself. She's amazingly talented. And if you don't like want to move in your seat when she's done, I'm going to be shocked. So I'm going to trade seats with you and let you kick us off.
Hello, everybody. Hello. My name is Robin D, and I'm going to perform an original piece of, I like to call it spoken word rather than poetry, but it's all the same. Because I am a woman, that's why. It's my reply to the inquisitive, inquiring minds that question why my smile shows no proof to what I've been through. And how my beauty seems to be untarnished, even though so much ugly has attempted to harm it to no avail, and how my eyes still sparkle with a glimpse of heaven when I've been to hell and back, because I am a woman. That's how. The epitome of strength, the original author to their phrase, I got this because I do. Because no matter the obstacle course that I tread through, six in stilettos still intact, with the weight of the world on my back, and babies on my hips, and red stained lips, I got this, I do this, I am this, because I am a woman. Inspired by struggle and bearing witness to the tears of my mother, and her mother, and her mother has gifted me. And when I feel the need to fall weak, to sit where I should stand, to whisper where I should shout, I tend to think long and hard about those that have sashayed down roads that were not so golden. Concrete paved gateways that women before us have opened, and I'll do them proud. And I'll smile through hidden scars, and I'll make do with my battle wounds and my broken heart to the facade that could win an Oscar, no speech, speechless. Because no term in the vocabulary dictated in dictionaries is sufficient enough to describe the makeup of us women. Fair-skinned, chocolate, caramel-complected, 22-inch wavy, chopped up or natural tresses, we all bear the resemblance to the appearance of a mere peasant that has the ambition of that of the queen. Because I am a woman, that's why. It's my reply when they ask how we maintain a steady heartbeat, even when it's been ripped to pieces by a man who's cheat on us and beat on us again and again, and by those obligated but have no intention to help raise our kids, and how we still sit pretty and poised while taking two TARC transits every day, sleet, snow, or rain to work. And in that moment when they mutter and mumble up under their breath about how we're able to keep our heads above water even after we've had to bury our sons and our daughters to acts of violence that have so many people of importance being so disrespectfully loud with their silence, it's because we're women, we're mothers, we've struggled, we're triumphant, we're troubled, we're beautiful, we're black, we're golden, we're young, and we're old, and we're women. That's how.
And Christy Love, I forgot when I sat down. Christy founded the Christy Love Foundation. Did you say it was in 2011?
Yes.
And tell them really quickly what it is.
It's a safe haven for women who've been victim of human trafficking.
And if that's not cool and sets the tone after that, I'm not really sure what yet. So Ashley Morgan, I'm so glad you're here. I was at a coffee shop, as so often things happen, with a friend of mine that I waited tables with, believe it or not, we're both lawyers. And he said, I have this woman that you have to meet. She did, she worked for the International Justice Mission in Cambodia to assess prosecutors in human trafficking. and sex trafficking, I think, as well. She is clerking for a judge in Lynn, Kentucky, graduated from Chase in 2012. And I cannot wait to hear her speak. I think she's going to talk for about 17, 20 minutes, something like that. So give your attention to Ashley Morgan, everybody.
Hello. I was going to time myself, but there's a clock back there, so okay. As she said, I'm Ashley Morgan. I just recently returned from Phnom Penh, Cambodia, where I completed a legal fellowship with the International Justice Mission. Before I tell you a little bit about IJM and the work that I did there, I think it's just important to kind of lay a framework of sex trafficking globally, and so I'm just going to give some information to you so we kind of have a basis to go on. So worldwide, there are nearly 2 million children in the commercial sex trade. Sex trafficking drives significant profits for perpetrators. It's about $150 billion market value. Though sex trafficking is a worldwide phenomenon, it is most pervasive in countries with weak justice systems, where perpetrators know that they are unlikely to face any significant consequences. So who is being trafficked? So the majority of people who are being trafficked come from a background of poverty. Women and children are very susceptible to this. They're impoverished women are especially susceptible to traffickers' schemes of deception because of the desperation of their economic situation. It makes them more susceptible to accept a perpetrator's fraudulent job offer, to change locations, to move to another city, to migrate to another country, or just believe anything that these traffickers are telling them. So what happens when these people are trafficked? So this is just within the context of IJM clients that I've seen. So they're subjected to serial rape, physical assault, forcibly injected with narcotics, and some instances are even forced to watch their own children be physically abused. There's also a high risk of HIV and AIDS, as well as other sexually transmitted diseases. So International Justice Mission is a human rights NGO that's based in Washington, D.C. That's where they're headquarters. They have about 20 offices all over the world in different developing countries where they work on different types of projects. They do everything from property seizure, where land is taken from widows in Africa, to child sexual assault in Latin America, to sex trafficking in Southeast Asia and India. I was really lucky to be placed in Cambodia. It's a beautiful country. Southeast Asia is really incredible. And IJM is just a really stellar organization. I love the model. I love how they do their casework. I think it's really impactful in the communities that they work in. So there's kind of four prongs to their model. So the first one is to rescue victims. So that means that we're going to pull victims out of their situations immediately. And they work with local law enforcement officers, so they work with anti-trafficking police on the ground to do investigations to see where children are being sold for sex. Then they kind of lay the groundwork to do a successful operation. They use undercover agents, undercover officers, undercover citizens to go and to gather information and to do an operation. So that's part one. The second is to bring criminals to justice. So it's not enough to rescue the victim, but we want to create an environment of deterrence to make sure that criminals who want to do this know that if that there are people watching for it and that they're going to go to jail for a very long time. And so we advocate for police reports to be filed against criminals, and we support public prosecutors as they take the case through the system. Thirdly, we restore survivors. So it's not enough to just rescue victims. It's not enough to just put the criminal in jail, but we have to take care of our clients. So we have, in every office that IJM has, they have a group of social workers who come alongside these clients and walk with them for a few years, doing everything from, you know, it's all individualized to their needs, and they do trauma care, they do vocational training. There's a whole list of things that they do with these clients, and like I said, it just kind of depends on their specific needs. And the last thing that IJAM does, which is something that I think is really, really cool, is they want to strengthen public justice systems. So IJAM wants to go into community and essentially put themselves out of business. They want the public justice system to function the way that it's intended to, so that people are protected by rule of law, and it's not just the rich people who get, you know, who can afford private security, but it's the people taking care of the most vulnerable in their society. So IJAM, like I said, works all over the world. Cambodia is one of their first offices that they opened, and they opened it in around 2003. If you've ever heard anything about Southeast Asia or about Cambodia specifically, you're probably, you know, thinking of these news reports that you've seen where children are being sold, you know, on the streets, and no one's doing anything about it. And that really was the case in 2003 when they moved into Cambodia. There are cases where there were six-year-olds just being sold on the sidewalk for sex. And a lot of times the police officers would either turn a blind eye, or they would get paid off to, you know, not arrest those people that were doing those things. Cambodia has a very tragic history. There's been a lot of war that's happened, and in the late 70s, the Khmer Rouge, there was a genocide. So the justice system is still, even today, kind of very simplistic. It's constantly, like, we're coming, you know, we come into issues all the time because it's not very developed, and so there are issues with, you know, how we can prosecute a case effectively. During the genocide, they killed all the educated professionals in Cambodia. So all the teachers, judges, lawyers, they were all killed. So when they started rebuilding their country in the 80s, there were untrained people who were making really important decisions and who were, you know, taking care of, like, government practice. And so the country is still very much trying to overcome what happened, you know, 30, 40 years ago. Which was very difficult even in the past year, just like running into those roadblocks. So when IJAM opened its office in 2004, laws weren't being enforced. There was no deterrence. Criminals were getting away with everything. And since they have started working there, they got the first conviction under the anti-human trafficking law in 2004. So it was the first time someone was actually put into jail for trafficking. So that was a huge thing. And since that time, they've rescued more than 500 victims of sex trafficking. They've ensured that 198 criminals were convicted. They've trained more than 500 anti-trafficking police officers. And they've worked alongside foreign embassies to convict and deport foreign pedophiles for further prosecution. Now, just to tell you a little bit about what I did when I was in Cambodia. Like I said, I did a legal fellowship while I was there, so it was an unpaid year of working alongside this office. A fellowship is essentially for a person who has a few years of experience or has their master's or doctorate degree. So I was able to go and work as a fellow. I worked with the legal team, and so there were three Khmer staff that were with me. There is a attorney, his name is Sarun, and he is amazing, and he actually started with IJAM as an informant when they first went in, so he's, like, worked his way up, you know, through law school, and he is the leading trafficking attorney in Cambodia, so it was quite the honor to work with him, and he's just a really humble, amazing person, and it was just so inspiring to work with him, you know, and he's seen all the changes that happened in Cambodia, so I feel like I learned so much from him. And then there were two other support staff, so a legal officer who essentially works as a paralegal, and then like an assistant. And I did all kinds of things while I was there. I did more traditional, like, legal work, and then I did some non-traditional work that, you know, definitely put me out of my comfort zone, but I felt like definitely helped improve, you know, my skill set, and, you know, that stuff that in the future hopefully will come back and help me in my career. So I did case management. That was one of the things that I did. So we had investigations, legal, and aftercare doing the casework. So I looked at the entire case as it went through our office, and if there were any kind of problems, You know, what were we not getting information to the police to do an operation, even though we had identified a pedophile in the community? Was a case not being transferred for to a higher court? What was the problem there? You know, were we losing contact with clients in our aftercare? I kind of looked at all the cases. I managed about 40 cases while I was there. And that was really cool because I got to talk to all the different casework teams. So I got to know what was going on in the entire office, which was really fun to do. So I just essentially problem solved and worked our contacts at foreign embassies, worked our contacts in the government to see what the problem was and how we could fix it. If anyone's worked in a developing country before, you know that everything goes pretty slowly, and as an American, sometimes that can be very frustrating because we want things to happen like this, and it doesn't always happen like that in developing places. So that was one thing that I did, taught me a lot. I also did case strategy and trial preparation, so I would work with our clients, getting them ready to testify in court. We worked with basically only minors, so people under 18. So working with them to make sure they knew how to answer questions, they knew what the courtroom was going to look like, they knew what to say when they went in there, you know, what kind of questions to anticipate, just so that they would be able to go in and feel really confident to give their testimony in court. I also kind of mentored the attorney that was there, which was kind of an interesting aspect of my job. I was told I needed to manage up, whatever that means, which kind of means that he was teaching me a lot, but there are things that I could bring from my experience in the U.S. and also through my own practice. So I was kind of talking with him, you know, is this the best way to do things? Like, we're kind of losing focus when we do it this way. Maybe we should do it that way. So just kind of holistically looking at how we do casework and, you know, how we can do it more efficiently to help our clients. I also worked with embassies, like I said before, if we had any foreign pedophile cases, I worked with embassies getting information to them and that sort of thing. We were in court a lot. We had a lot of cases, which was really fun to go into court. Everything was in another language, so that was interesting to have everything being translated to me. You obviously lose a little in translation, but still a really fascinating process. The way that IJM gets to work in these types of cases, here in the U.S., civil and criminal cases happen separately at, you know, different times. In Cambodia, they actually happen at the same time, so you'll have a criminal and civil case tried together. So it's still the same in that the prosecutor who works for the government is prosecuting for the criminal aspect, but then we would come in and ask for civil compensation for our clients. And that's good because sometimes the prosecutors, there obviously is corruption in every government. There's corruption in Cambodia. And so that was a great way for us to get our foot in the door. And if the prosecutor dropped the ball, then Sarun, our attorney, could literally do the whole case. I mean, he could do the criminal aspect and he could do the civil case. So it just ensured that there was that extra little bit of accountability to the people who were working the case, that IJM's here, and if something doesn't happen or evidence not brought up or you're not doing your job, we can, you know, kind of support that and hold up the case in court. So that's actually how we were able to be involved with these cases in the first place. There were two projects that I did specifically when I was there. The first thing I did, we had a case involving a foreign pedophile who had been living in Cambodia for about 10 years. He was working as a school teacher and was essentially abusing some boys in this community. There was another organization that had been kind of tracking him and his behavior for a while, and they tried to get the municipal police to get involved, and they weren't really interested in practicing or, you know, picking up this guy. So we got involved. Our investigations team did some more. We got involved with the anti-trafficking police, which they're actually a very capable police unit in Cambodia. They're the most professional and really invested in the work that they do in Cambodia. So we got them involved and we ended up picking up this guy. This happened like maybe a month after I got to Cambodia last June. And then we went to trial, and so we got a conviction. Cambodia doesn't have very strong conviction law, so, you know, he's been abusing these boys. There was, I think, like 12 victims. The youngest was six. and he gets 5 years. You know, that is totally not a good sentence. But I worked with the Australian embassy and got all the evidence together. He had taken some pictures that we were able to get off his laptop, got all the pictures together, typed transcripts to the trials, which there's no transcription in trials, so I just did that so they'd have that information, and just like tried to give them as much as I can, because after he serves his 5-year sentence, he's going to be deported back to Australia. And Australia is very similar to the U.S. in that if you commit a crime against a child in a foreign country, you can also be prosecuted for that when you get back to your home country. So he's going to be mandatory. He's got to go when he's done with his 5-year sentence. He's going to go back to Australia and hopefully get prosecuted again and go to jail for a really, really long time. So that was really incredible to be a part of that, to work, you know, internationally with a, you know, different embassy. And then also just to feel like I made a difference in making Cambodia safer for these kids and also Australia safer for kids. That just felt like super rewarding. And I just really, as hard as it was to look at those pictures and get that evidence together, and hear what these boys had gone through, just knowing that they were safer and people were safer because of some of the work that I had a hand in doing, was just really rewarding. And the second big project that I got to do when I was there is I wrote a curriculum for judges, prosecutors, and police officers on how to implement child-friendly practices in a court. Cambodia, like I said, is still pretty new in how they're running trafficking cases, and they don't treat children very well in the court. They don't understand that sometimes these kids are held, while they might not be physically held to the place where they're being exploited, you know, there's threat of, you know, their families being hurt, there's economic pressure for them to stay, they don't really have anywhere else to go. So they're treated sometimes like they're the criminal in the case. And so not only is that not effective for a good criminal case when you're, you know, traumatizing your star witness during court, you know, it also doesn't help them in their therapeutic process, right? Because we want these kids to feel strengthened and empowered by having a part in ensuring that their abuser goes to jail, that they have a part in that, and that it's a positive experience rather than a negative experience. So I got to work with a lot of social workers, and then talked to a lot of police and prosecutors and judges, and worked on this curriculum for about 4 months. And then before I left Cambodia, we got to train about 200 Cambodian government officials on my curriculum, and it was really awesome and cool to see, and just see them kind of get the information. So I'm very interested to see like how it's put into practice, because they have manuals now. They did 2 full days of training with other experts, with social workers, with our attorney. You know, lots of like small group discussion on how, you know, how we can take care of kids in the public justice system and in a criminal case. And Cambodia has grown so much because of the investment of these government officials. We've seen prevalence decrease. They did a prevalence study, IJM did, and when they first started working in Cambodia, they found that between 15 and 30% of all trafficking victims were kids, so under 18. And in the past 10 years, because of the involvement from the government and the Cambodian government and police just buying into this and working on growing in their professional capacity, we've seen prevalence of minors like plummet. And so there was a statistic that came out in the 2013 report that says now they're seeing that kids 15 and younger in trafficking is 0.1%. So that's huge. There's still a lot of borderline minors, so that's your 16 and 17 year olds. But for 15 and younger, I mean, that's incredible. So it was just really cool to work in a place where they're supporting the public justice system and they're doing really great work and they want to build capacity in the country so that they can take care of themselves. And it was just really rewarding. And yeah, so that's kind of just a summary of what I did and what I learned. Thank you so much for letting me share. If you have questions or you want more information about IJM, their website is ijm.org. They're a great organization. Check them out. So, thank you.
So, I have had the privilege since I've lived here. I'm a vegetarian, not a vegetarian place to eat, and we're all getting better, of going to Ramsey's on Bardstown Road. Ramsey and Rona are here with their daughter and their family, and she's going to tell us about her experience for a school project that she had and a cool interview, and what she thinks about women who are where you were, and how maybe we can intervene or not intervene, or whatever your impressions were of that trip. So she's going to come up, but we're also going to have the other speaker come up too. At the same time, Nan, Ahina, Deshara, and we're going to put them so that they can have a little love while they're all together up on the stage. So I want everybody to come up. If you want to sit, if you're more comfortable, everybody. And I just, Danny Alvarez, where's Danny? Danny's running for a candidate in district court, and obviously cares about women and human rights, so I'm going to recognize him while he's here.
Thank you to all of you.
Hi, so I'm Graciela. I'm a senior at St. Francis. I'm doing my senior project on women in occupied Palestine. And I'm focusing a lot on like the relationship between the women's liberation movement there and the Palestinian liberation movement, and how they've kind of grown together and evolved into very similar movements. I visited Palestine a lot, or a few times as I was growing up, and I remember seeing like soldiers and going through checkpoints and everything, but I never really understood like what was going on until more recently. And as I've learned more about the situation, it's kind of become a really personal issue and something that's very important to me. So I decided to do my senior project on it. And while I was there this past summer doing research, I got to interview a woman who has been a political prisoner. She's one of the longest, or the one who's been in prison the longest, in Palestine, and she has, her name's Ida Essawi, and she was first arrested in college for being involved with the Democratic Front for the Liberation of Palestine, because it was illegal then to be there. But she's been arrested a lot of times since then, and she's had family members be arrested as well. She runs the Women's Study Center in Jerusalem, which focuses a lot on improving access to education for women. Which she, when I was interviewing her, she said that that's definitely one of a very important thing to get women educated so they can get better jobs and get have more presence in the community. And she also focuses on trying to get women equally represented in politics. About 50% of the voters in Palestine are women, but there's definitely not the same statistics in women who are elected officials. A lot of that has to do with there just aren't female candidates. But it was, while I was there, I also visited refugee camps and got to see a lot of the effects of the occupation on women. And it's definitely very personal. It affects women in a different way, definitely. There's always the risk of sexual assault, but even more so in occupied territory. The risk of losing their homes and their families and, you know, children, all that. It was definitely a very interesting experience and something that That's pretty good.
And we have Nan next, but Nan's out of order, so we're going to go to, where is Mary Sue? Mary Sue's going to introduce the next two speakers.
I have the pleasure to introduce Ohinaba Ohin and Deshara Dahl. Just a couple words on how I got to know them. I was the campus minister at St. Catherine College in Springfield, and I met Ohinaba, who was a student there. And we went to the UN together. So Ohinaba has been to the CSW in New York, and that was a powerful experience. And Deshara, I became familiar, have gotten to know you through the seminary, Louisville Seminary. I was director of the Women's Center there. And just a couple words about your presence on the panel today. The treaty, CEDAW, is very comprehensive, as you know. It is written, it was drafted with girls and women in mind all over the world in diverse situations with diverse identities. So in our efforts to implement the principles of that huge treaty on a local level, we have to address it that way as comprehensively and as inclusive as possible. So the feminism of the Louisville Coalition cannot be white feminism. We have to constantly and honestly drive ourselves to aspire to intersectional feminism. And that is to be aware that multiple oppressions intersect in any given girl's life or woman's life. Okay, so racial and ethnic identity, sexual orientation and gender identity, all of these things can further marginalize any particular girl or woman. So what I want to say is that I am privileged. As a white woman, I'm privileged, but my soul is privileged to know these two young women and to have them share with me not only their empowerment, but their vulnerabilities. And for them to be here is a risk. It is truly a risk. And so I want to thank you for taking the risk and for being willing to sort of poise yourself to speak your voice in a challenging situation. You're brave and courageous, and I thank you for that. I think that young women's voices, I was at the UN again this past March, and I met a young woman from Mexico City. And we were talking, and she said, I just want to ask people here at the UN how young women can use their voices and have their voices heard while we're still young women. So I think tonight is something in the spirit of that. Although I beg to differ a little with Holly, I think women of all ages and all identities as women and girls need to speak voices, okay? We're never too old to speak our voices. Right, Holly? Okay. So Ohinaba and Deshara, welcome.
Nervous, but I am here to share a little piece of myself with everyone here. I was born in Togo, and we were forced to move to Germany because of the war, and it was no longer safe. So we went to Germany, and most of my childhood, well, until 9, I was in Germany. And I never really saw the difference between everyone that I was interacting with. So that means the children, school, everything was very much community-based. And the differences that I started seeing was when I came to the United States. That's when I realized that I'm a girl, you know, I'm not one of you or you. And everyone that I interacted with made it very well made me very well aware that you're a girl, you can't do this, or you're a girl, you're not allowed to do this. So I became very, I don't know how to describe this. I kind of went in myself. I became like a turtle, you know, kind of very reserved, and I'm still like that. But one thing that I wanted to touch base on is, while in Africa, where I lived, everyone was, we were all, it was a community, kind of, so to speak. I could be out playing and a neighbor can reprimand me for something that they thought I was doing wrong. And I remember very clearly when we were getting ready to go, when my parents sent for me and my brother, and we had a tutor. He was a male figure, and he wanted to keep me in Africa. He didn't want me to go. And he had his mind made up, and he was convincing everyone else in the community and my grandparents to let me stay and for my brother to go. And he almost won. But I had my grandmother by my side, on my side, and she kind of fought for me. And I remember that very clearly, just because I almost didn't go, you know. And I kind of, my inner strength, I kind of see that it came from my grandmother, just seeing that she was there for me, she fought for me. So that was very eye-opening. One of the other kind of instances that I wanted to touch base on is in the workplace, how I am treated differently than someone that is on the same level as me, or someone that is a level below me. One, I work in customer service. I talk to people over the phone, not in person. So couple times a phone call will come in. One that I remember clearly is I had another woman with me. I was training her. She was new. And a phone call came through, and I introduced myself, and I helped the gentleman, who was a male, with what he needed with his accounts. And towards the end, he said, I asked him if there was anything else that I could help him with, and he said no, but he asked my name again, and I instantly knew where this was going. I told him my name is Oheniba, and he asked me how to spell it, so I spelled it for him, and then he said, are you jet black? Mm-hmm. And I kind of had I was kind of confused. I was like, what do you mean? He said, are you jet black? And I kind of looked at my skin color. I said, no, sir, I am not. And he said, oh, I just assumed, you know, since you were from Africa that you are jet black. And I said, no. Actually, there's white people in Africa, too. Some of the things that I want to say, I can't say just because our calls are recorded and I was getting in trouble, and he would, you know, he would still be, have his accounts at the bank. So a couple of instances like that happened, and I kind of just had to brush it off. And one question that I always ask myself is, there's so many occasions that I want to say something, but I feel as though I can't because I'm not allowed to, or because that's just the way I've grown up, or it's not ladylike or just a whole bunch of nonsense. So that's where I am right now.
Well, again, my name is Deshara. I am currently studying to be a marriage and family therapist, and that has definitely been a move that I had never anticipated on. Definitely studying to be a therapist, my first in my family to pursue higher education, as well as being in a seminary, definitely discerning a call for helping people to be in the community to advocate. Interesting enough, when I first came to seminary, I had looked at the school for about 4 years and really did not feel like I was worthy of being in such a place. I had heard so many tricklings about seminary, about women being in ministry, and that we didn't have our place. And I grew up in the Baptist tradition where I never saw a woman in the pulpit. The women had to step off the podium and go to the side and talk to parishioners. And so going after a call to help people and also breaking barriers as a woman has been a fight. I feel like I fought from the very first day of me entering. But first off, I want to tell Mary Sue thank you for everything that she said. I had an experience, and I'm gonna try to keep it together. But I feel like it's really important to talk about here because we never know what our silence can do. When we watch people get hurt or people be abused and we stay silent. We stay silent maybe because of fear, maybe because it's not us, it's not our issue. But I first entered seminary and had a supervisor that had been rumored to, you know, flex her supervision, her authority with many people over the years. Many people that could not stand up to her, that could not say anything and dropped out. I knew the struggle and the sacrifices I made to be in school, so I knew dropping out was not an option for me as I entered supervision with this particular woman. And I decided to go natural when I entered seminary. I feel like it was almost a political move now that I'm thinking about it. I feel like it's something about sometimes when a woman goes natural that you just get to know yourself a little bit more than you did before. You know, I had relaxers for 20 years, and I started to realize that, you know, my image of beauty was based off of what I saw on TV or in magazines, and I didn't find myself to be very beautiful, and I was afraid to cut off this hair that everybody loved and adored growing up. So I decided that, you know, I go to seminary, I'm gonna cut my hair too. We're just gonna, you know, go into the pool. And so I also decided to diet. I just did everything when I first got there. But one day, this particular lady decided to ask me about my hair. She asked me, "What's going on with your hair?" And I didn't know where this was going. I said, "Well, what do you mean?" She said, "Well, it looks like Raggedy Ann." Mm-hmm. And again, you have to make a decision at that moment. I was in a public place. I was amongst my peers. I was amongst authority. And I could either do what I am naturally capable of doing, which would have got me kicked out of school, or I could have rose above. And I decided to rise above that day. But I did not want her to see me fall. I didn't want her to see me be affected by what she said. And I said, "Well, you know, my hair should remind you of fall instead of Raggedy Ann." And I think at that very moment, she knew that I was not going to be the one to play with any longer. I recognize people live in a spirit of fear when it comes to reporting, when it comes to standing up and saying something. but I decided that I wasn't going to take it any longer. Again, I was an entering student. I didn't know what to say. I was very hurt by the situation because, you know, I never had any ill interaction with her. I didn't know where that had came from. I'm already feeling fear with my hair. I don't know how I look to people. Again, not having that confidence. And again, Mary Sue knew where she was supposed to be at the time she was supposed to be there because I relied on another woman to, first of all, cry to tell her that I didn't want to be a victim any longer. Mm-hmm. That I was not going to allow someone to ruin my call to help people. So I decided to report this supervisor. And I was fearful, but I did it. This reporting of the supervisor led to a conversation with a committee, which led to a conversation with the school. And now next week, we're having an anti-racism training for the entire school. Emotional because I wanted to share that because I feel like a lot of times we as women of color, we as young women, don't feel like we need to make our voices heard. We live in the spirit of fear a lot because of authority, because people have been so accustomed to being able to say whatever they want to say without consequence. I felt like in that very moment when she said that, we was in the midst of the beginnings of the Black Lives Matter movement in this city. I'm a member of a sorority. My sorority sister was died under police custody, under suspicious circumstances. I watched a school that was impossible to sustain minorities be able to speak of my voice as the only Black female in the marriage and family therapy program. And I felt like I wanted to make it better, even if it wasn't for me, for somebody else. And so although I have went through a lot of struggles, I felt like that was so empowering. And that's why I can't do nothing but support CEDAW and the mission for equality and the mission for women to have a voice. And so I encourage each of you all in here, even if you don't understand what I'm talking about, you've never experienced it yourself, understand that your silence, when you don't speak up for someone else, it could be very detrimental. Because unfortunately, no one spoke up for me that day. I had an incident again, 3 weeks ago actually, with a male that said my hair, what is it, Halloween? I was like, what's going on with my hair? These comments. And I even felt compelled at that moment to say, I don't think that that's appropriate. We don't have a personal relationship. You shouldn't make comments to me in that nature. And I think at that moment, he even took a step back like, wow, I'm so sorry. But again, that forward thought, when people feel like that they can say whatever they want to say, and then we feel like we have to be silent. And so I grew a sense of confidence. I am very proud of my hair. I make sure it's done every day. I also share this story not to embarrass anyone involved, not to embarrass my school or the program, but to make everyone aware that this is even happening in religious institutions. It's not just public spaces, it's not just private spaces, it's not just trafficking or in other countries. It's happening in our place of refuge, where people go to be vulnerable, to lay their burdens down, to not be in the spirit of fear. And I feel empowered by that. So I'm grateful that a gift for Mary Sue, because Lord have mercy, I went to her office so many times, like, I don't know what to do. I felt defeated because I said this happened last year, and all of a sudden something is happening this year, but unfortunately I have to see the supervisor still every day. Because although nothing happened with that particular person, it has the opportunity to impact the entire campus. And so although it's not directly for me, I want to make a path of assistance and help and refuge for someone else. And I think that that's what's so important with this work, to make the path for others, even if you're not experiencing the issue yourselves. Thank you all so much.
You know, what's interesting to me is how we learn boundaries. I don't know about you guys, but I didn't grow up with boundaries, really. My parents didn't have great boundaries, and I didn't grow up with boundaries. And you have to learn boundaries because I have to do what you did, which is say to somebody straight in the face, that's not okay. You know, and how many of us are able to say, and at what age, and look at somebody wherever we are, whether we're at work, whether we're at school, wherever we are, which was the motivation for the resolution for women and girls. You know, that was one of our primary motivations. It's for us to be able to say, no matter what we look like, no matter what color we are, no matter what gender we are, no matter where we are, that's not okay. And then be able to follow through with it. And, you know, that's why we have the justice system that Ashley referenced in Cambodia. You took U.S. law over there and wrote policy, you know, and Judge Bowles puts the teeth into the boundaries, because sometimes we need boundaries that aren't just personal ones. We need boundaries that are legal ones that will put somebody's rear end in a jail cell when they don't do what they're supposed to do. And I'm really grateful that we have that kind of structure here, but we have to start at the personal level, where in your stomach, in your gut, you know, where all your fear and all your good stuff is sometimes too, where when you get that kind of feeling and it's just like, ugh, and you know something's wrong, that you're able to say, that's not okay. And it takes more courage, I think, than people ever realize. And I want to teach that. If I had a wish for everybody, my wish would be that everybody is able to recognize that and to say, this is not okay. This is not okay with me. And you have to push back sometimes. So that happened to us recently on social media. Nan and I haven't met yet, but my heart and everything went out to her immediately to have the courage that she has to organize what she organized at 18. I don't think, I was rebellious. I wasn't courageous, I was rebellious. Those are two completely different things. And the flack that she got, you know, everything, we just kind of went, I'm not gonna let anybody beat up on her because I can't tolerate it, which is what Deshara said. Nobody's gonna do that with me in the room. You know, I'm definitely gonna call them out. So tell us a little bit just about your experience afterward, and then hopefully we can get into the solutions part and figure out ways that we can deal with people that came after you almost personally and said, how dare you do this, right?
Privileged to be here, to be with these three women, and also privileged because I'm a white, middle-class person in America, which is an amazing thing, but I'm still a woman. And no matter who you are, if you're a woman, you should know that we're not there yet. That wherever you are, you have more to ask and you have a lot more to expect. So that's what the Free the Nipple campaign is about. The Free the Nipple campaign was started by Mina Esko in New York City to change public policies. She was working on the 14th Amendment and about censorship of women's breasts being shown in public. It's legal in all 50 states but three, and a lot of people don't know that. In the last year, 34,000 NYPD officers had to be issued a reminder that they cannot arrest women who are topless in public. Okay, so a lot of this is about education. My piece on this is that last winter, the original promo video for the Free the Nipple movie started circulating on Facebook, and the idea that really hit me in a way that I hadn't thought before is that we hypersexualize women's bodies because they are covered. There is nothing inherently sexual or secret about women's bodies, especially over men's, to make us cover them in that way. So therein lies the problem. It started out as a joke among my friends, this is crazy, this is out there, let's do this, and it wasn't until I started a gender class at St. Francis High School, where Graciela also goes, that I thought, you know, we could maybe do this. So I went on Facebook and invited 38 friends that I know personally to have a Free the Nipple campaign march with me down Barkstown Road, hoping maybe 5, 10 would agree to come. and I did not hit the invite only button. So the next morning, 15 people were coming and 400 people were invited. And from there, it snowballed and got way out of hand in a very good way. We ended up having about 400 people at the event, and I was getting media within the week. I've done articles with articles or TV interviews with about 5 different stations and newspapers in the city. So this issue is hot right now, and the exciting thing is that we are the first city in Kentucky to do so. What's also especially interesting about our geographical location is that 2 of the 3 states where it's illegal for women to be topless are Tennessee and Indiana. So we're right in the middle of our lives. So we marched on last Saturday. There were about 400 of us. Unfortunately and expectedly, there were a lot of blockers. Some people came up with video cameras that who knows what they used them for afterwards. And we had one guy sitting welcoming us back into the park in a lawn chair with his camouflage shirt on, just looking, you know, comments like, "Will you guys do this every Saturday?" But the point is that the good far outweighed the bad. The point of Free the Nipple campaign is to desensitize people to women's bodies. Hypersexualization of our bodies gives people the right to victim blame, to slut shame, and to shun women who are breastfeeding in public, using their bodies for the biological purpose. And in my mind, if it's gone so far that we cannot recognize a beautiful thing such as feeding a child, using the breast what they're biologically meant for, because our society sexualizes our bodies, that's where we have to draw the line. The amazing thing is that I have gotten so many comments from women, girls, and even men that I don't know on Facebook or people that I do know in the halls on the streets who have given me their very personal reasons for supporting this campaign, whether they were sexually abused as children, this is specific to girls, and then asked what they were wearing, whether they don't feel comfortable walking down the streets of our city because they get catcalled. It's a wide range, and that's why I think that Louisville is able to take this campaign at this time, because we're liberal enough and we're open enough, we have enough diversity to make this happen because it appeals to such a broad range of people. There's been a lot of negative critique, obviously. Some of that is just uneducated and disgusting, which is disappointing, but that's a risk that we are trying to take in desensitizing people, because the point is to shock. One woman who did the same thing, also by accident, in New Hampshire last month, you know, emailed me for, you know, if I had any questions and to help, and she said, if you called this march a women's march or an equality march, you would get nothing. It's the topless part that gets people interested, obviously, and the difficult thing and the counterintuitive part is that we are putting our bodies out there expecting them to be sexualized, but with the hope that that will stop. This is a risky campaign, and some of the comments I've gotten back are, you know, even for people who care, even for feminists, is it worth it to put yourself out there in a potentially dangerous situation? For me, because of the privilege that I have, yes. I would never encourage anyone to do this alone at night in a place where they didn't feel totally comfortable, in a city that wasn't able to respect them for who they are. Louisville is a place that we can do this. And it's important to have marches and public gatherings right now because we do have strength in numbers. So I guess most basically what I would say to people who are questioning this is that we have to go big or go home. And that's why we want to make it a national campaign. So I guess one of the points that I would try to drive is that, and this is something that I've been thinking of over the past couple of days, I did an interview with Rusty Satellite yesterday at my school, is that women are not given a physical sense of self. What you wear is assumed to be projected on the people that you're going to see that day. If you put on makeup, it's because you feel insecure and you want to impress someone. If you have your boobs out, it's because you want other people to see them. There's no allowance for you to dress and put yourself out there as you want to be seen yourself. So that's the reason that this campaign is important to me. Something that I've struggled with is that, you know, in hearing you three women, that some people have it so much worse. We're not talking about sex trafficking here, and that's hard because this is a privileged campaign, But it's something that we can do here and now. It's something that everyone can be a part of and support in an easy way. I would encourage you, if this issue matters to you, to get in touch with us. We have an Instagram, we have an email, and a Facebook, and I can leave those to Polly, and I'll post those on Facebook as well. But this issue is hot in Louisville right now because the media is interested right now. The point of this campaign is to get out there, and it's the people in this room, the changers, the shakers, who are going to be able to do that. I've shied away from reading the comments section because I think I am comfortable enough and confident enough in what this campaign means to me and what it means to the people that I've talked about that I don't need that negative feedback. That's not going to help us move forward unless it's the kind of critical feedback. Is this worth it? Is it safe? What are you doing next? I have sort of an official board meeting on Sunday with a few people who have really shown interest in this campaign to start moving forward. So we want to do more walks. We want to do topless picnics in the park. And a lot of that is not only for the media, not only to get our voice out there, but to empower the women who will be there. I had a lawyer working with me, she's also a neighbor and an activist, who came to the event, and she was kind of, you know, mentoring me through this process, and she was walking right by my side at the front of our march. We went from Bardstown Road by Qdoba to Douglas Loop and back into Willow Park, and she said, you know, Nan, I have this V-neck on, and it says, be fearless, and I don't feel that way. I can't quite get there. I want to be with you right now. I want to be topless, but I'm not there, and that's what social conditioning is about. And I looked back 5 minutes later, and she had her top off, and she and her husband were holding hands and walking down the street. So even in those small ways, this is about empowerment. It's about claiming your body. And eventually, if we get enough of us, the media is going to start respecting our bodies, but it has to start personally. That's what this campaign is about. And if you want more information, please talk to me.
Stuff that's going on in here. And Kylie, is Kylie still here? I'm going to recognize you because Kylie has an organization. She's a filmmaker, and she's a renowned filmmaker at this point. She's pretty cool stuff. She's got a little baby girl named Charlie. She's the cutest thing in the whole world. But she started an organization here called Raising Men's President. So when you're talking about school, and when you're talking about girls using their voices, and I think it was Graciela that talked about education and how important education is, Kylie Lane, please look up Raising Men's President if you're interested in how you can help girls run for office, because that's really what that organization's all about and why they don't, frankly, right? And Kelsey is here. Kelsey has an organization called Louisville Girls Leadership that is an advocacy group in Louisville for high schoolers, both public and private. It is an truth-telling. I'm part of that organization too, and that's how we know each other. They get sophomores in, I think it's two sophomores at every school now.
One at every school, but we have open application process for girls that aren't selected by their school. So a little bypass if you're really passionate.
And what do you do every April?
Every April we have a conference called Girls Idea Festival. So it's the students in our program taking the topics that they've learned about. Human trafficking is always at the forefront. Confidence is always at the forefront. Healthy relationships are at the forefront. And they take the things that they've learned throughout the year and use a peer education model to talk to other girls in the community that aren't a part of our program about it, try and light the fire in lots of different ways.
And Megan Rouse is behind you. And Megan is brave right now because she's leading the efforts for Planned Parenthood here, which is not a popular cause, maybe so much. Right. Have questions about that, please ask her that. And then if Judge Bowles, if you would share a little bit about the dating violence, the new stuff for the people in the room, and how that changes from the and you'll come on up here. Judge Bowles is probably comfortable speaking anywhere.
He used to be very shy, actually.
That's true. Maybe about dating violence, and then Gretchen, why don't you come up too, and you guys can kind of play off each other with the KSAT stuff. They're Louisville, Kentucky, sorry, I sometimes separate the two, but Kentucky has a human trafficking law that Representative Overly, who's running with Jack Conway now, was instrumental in being passed at the state level, which actually has more teeth than the federal regulation, and more importantly for us,
has a safe harbor provision so that when the juveniles come in as sex trafficking victims, rather than going straight into incarceration, that they can bypass and go into family court. Go into family court and be assigned to probably somebody like me, honestly, that will help them through the system. And Nima, will you come up too in case somebody has questions about immigration? So Judge Bold wrote the framework for domestic violence legislation, which has shifted recently to dating violence, and I'm going to let him talk about that.
Okay, thank you, Holly. Thank you all for inviting me here tonight. I'm going to give you just a brief background of how I got involved in this work. I started in 1984 as a young prosecutor prosecuting criminal cases in Jefferson County with the county attorney's office. And it didn't take me too long in that office to realize that when the victims of assaults that came through the court system were women, and they were victims of their intimate partners, that there was no consequences for those crimes. And so it was common lingo in the conference rooms of the Hall of Justice that people would come in and say, this is just a domestic violence case. And that then shifted the whole response to how those cases were dealt with. And in fact, they weren't dealt with. Probably 95% of those cases were dismissed in the court system. So that just seemed like a real injustice to me because I looked at people who were vulnerable, who weren't as powerful as their intimate partners in a physical way, and they were coming in and those cases were being dismissed, sometimes often at the victim's request, but then not recognizing or not taking into account that those people who were inflicting those crimes were the individuals who had power and control over the victims. And so it was, rather than asking a victim of domestic violence if they wanted their perpetrators prosecuted, as I started to process that analytically, I thought, why not just ask the defendants themselves if they wanted to be prosecuted, because that's who had power and control over those victims. And so I decided that I needed to do something about that. Which was not very popular in the district court in 1984. But I eventually got the county attorney's office to agree to let me start a specialized unit within the county attorney's office. It was actually the first specialized unit. Now there's a veterans court and a DUI court, but or division. But I started the domestic violence and sexual assault unit within the county attorney's office and went full-time as a prosecutor just prosecuting domestic violence and sexual assault in 91. So got involved at the state level and started working with some statewide task force to actually look at Kentucky's domestic violence laws and how we responded as a commonwealth to batters, and that the only way that domestic violence was going to stop in our community and in our commonwealth plus if there was some accountability to batterers. And so was fortunate enough to be on the Attorney General's task force in 92, that we passed some pretty sweeping legislation. And then in 96, we had some transforming legislation that was passed. We became the first state in the nation that actually had a registry of protective orders, civil protection orders. We started a governor's Council on Domestic Violence, which I co-chaired with Governor Patton's wife, then Jean Patton, First Lady, ultimately went on to the bench, and it's kind of been my passion and my work for the 19 years that I served as a family court judge. And through that work, I've been fortunate enough to not only provide training and peer review for judges across the Commonwealth, but I've also been invited to about 45 states, including Alaska and Hawaii, to train their judges on how judges can effectively intervene in domestic violence cases. And then over the last 10 years, I've got to take that work internationally. I've been working in China. I've been over there three different times as we've developed a pilot program in the Chinese courts for civil protection orders and then criminal protection orders. And I'm actually going in December to Bosnia, to Sarajevo, to start a project in that country. So it's been exciting work. As far as Kentucky, while we had the first full faith and credit legislation that recognized protection orders for domestic violence victims that move here or flee here to other states. We had the three misdemeanors becomes a felony, which I helped author that legislation to increase the penalties to make, because most domestic violence, because it's by someone who's physically stronger than you, is with the hands, and so it was traditionally misdemeanors. It was only when the victim grabs a knife or some weapon to equalize that strength that then they're charged with the felony. So we had a lot of women in prison for felony assaults when they were responding to or reacting to the violence because of their vulnerability. And so in 96, I helped draft the legislation that makes multiple misdemeanors, three misdemeanors, a felony offense in Kentucky. So we have very progressive laws. And have been known throughout the country, but the one thing we didn't have, and we've really fought for a long time, because whenever you move forward, there's always some backlash, is the dating violence. And so in Kentucky, if you were married, if you were related to a certain level of relationship, or if you had lived together as an intimate partner, or if you had a child in common, you qualified for protection if your intimate partner was abusive. But if you had never moved in with your partner, and or never had had a child by your partner, or never married your partner, you didn't qualify for the protection. And so as I tried years and years to describe that to the legislature, there is this pie of people who are vulnerable in our community and in our Commonwealth, and we're protecting about two-thirds of them. And there's a third of them that can't get protection because they have never had a child by or moved in with their abusers. And yet the danger or risk to them and their safety is just as great. And so just this past year now, we have been able to finally, after about 10 times going to the legislature, got our good old boys in the legislature to agree to protect the entire pie of people who are vulnerable. So with that piece of legislation came some other protections that I'm going to let Gretchen talk.
I want to speak really briefly because there's just incredible power up here on the stage, and I feel like I need to step down from the podium to honor these women, and it's just incredible to hear the wisdom, and it's incredible to share a stage with both Nima and Judge Bowles. And Judge Bowles is someone who so many of us look up to as a mentor and a male ally who has been profoundly impactful on so many lives and has saved so many lives in this community. So you're standing in the presence of greatness, and he is very humble about his work. So a couple of things. I'm staff attorney with the Kentucky Association of Sexual Assault Programs. So the Center for Women and Families here in Louisville is one of our member programs. Always there for assistance for victims of rape, sexual assault, and domestic violence, as well as sex trafficking. I've worked in this field for 15 years, really brought to it because I think I had strong women who guided me, and that radical sense that we can actually improve women's well-being, and in the process actually improve the well-being of men and boys as well. So everything here that we've said improves the overall well-being. The protective order statute actually changed to also include victims of sexual assault and stalking who can seek protective orders as well. And I want to just say, as a solution, as you think about these powerful narratives that have come up on stage, how you translate that, and I will just give two quick solutions because I'm an attorney and I like to find solutions, right? That's why some of us went into this field, is that you want to both change laws, and the way that you change laws, which do change culture over time, is stories and narratives of those who are impacted, and the profound way in which people can use words and their stories to impact your legislators. We need more women in office as well. We rank 43rd in the country in terms of women in our state legislature. I tried to tinker with that, not done yet, but not successfully. But that's not at all unrelated to our statistics on violence. For example, 47% of Kentucky women will experience sexual violence. I think those numbers are actually related. So you need changes in laws, but then you also need to implement the laws and hold policymakers and our justice system accountable. And so when I hear these rich narratives and stories, and Ashley, when you talked about the justice system and some of the gaps, I'm thinking in my head, I want IJM to also come back here, because we have alarming rates of an impunity for people who perpetrated particular sex crimes against children and women in our midst. So 92 to 98% of reports of rape are truthful, and yet we still have a culture that talks about the culture of false reporting. 93 to 98% of rapists will not spend one day in jail. That's in the United States. And still, in spite of our human trafficking law being passed 2 years ago, which is the strongest safe harbor in the nation, in the past couple weeks, and I've worked with my trafficking advocates, we have been rallying against reports of young women, teenage girls, being locked up even still, even though the law says that they can't be locked up. So the need to hold those accountable is just very, very important. So when we look to solutions, definitely keep sharing your voices, impact legislation, and also think about how you enforce the laws that we have. Because no doubt, we also still need judges who will be willing to issue protective orders and follow the law. We have very good laws on these crimes, but as Judge Bowles knows, there are a lot of things that may impact whether or not judges will still issue these protective orders.
Yeah, that's an excellent point that Gretchen makes. It's so important to know who you're electing when you elect judges, because it's one thing to have laws on the books, but the implementation and how those laws are applied and how they're used in the court systems is critical. We have a district court election this year. There's 22 candidates on the ballot running for that district court seat, and I think we have one candidate here who was willing to come and pardon?
Brave enough to
come. And, you know, diversity, you all talked about how important diversity is, and so Danny Alvarez is somebody that is definitely worthy of your support and that I've known for a long time, and so I want to put a plug in for you for being here and being a part of this group.